Hello friends, welcome to Geeky Rabbit. Welcome to our today's session in the Java series, where we focus on creating simple Java programs that will help you out clear your Java basics. In the last session, we saw about the conditional if-else statement. Now today, we can see about the switch statement, which can be considered as a specialized if statement. It can be useful in times when you want to compare a single variable with a number of different values. The switch statement will execute one statement from multiple conditions. It is similar to the if-else if statement that we saw in our earlier sessions. Switch statement works with byte, short, int, long types. After the release of Java 7, we can also use string in the switch statement. So let us see the syntax first. So syntax of switch statement is something like this. The switch, the expression will go in here, and then case by case it will be compared. So suppose whatever expression value we have given in here, if it is equal to this, then this part of code will be executed and it will break after it. And if suppose then if it is not equal to this, then it will continue to the second case, and then this part, if it is matches, then this part of code will be executed and after that it will break. But if suppose there are no matching, then it will go and print the code which is there in the default case. And we can have any number of case depending upon our conditions in here, and we can have the default case at the end as well as in between. So there are some important rules while creating this switch statements. So duplicate case values are not allowed in here. The value for a case must be of the same data type as the variable in switch. Then the value for a case must be a constant or a literal. It cannot be a variable. The break statement is used inside the switch to terminate a statement sequence, and the break statement is optional. If omitted, execution will continue on to the next case, and the default statement, which is used at the last in here, is optional and can appear anywhere inside the switch block. In case if it is not at the end, then a break statement must be kept after the default statement to omit the execution of the next case statement. So let us now see an example for switch statement. In here, we'll ask for the student about his engineering branch, and in response, we'll print the list of subject he has to study for his first year. So for checking this, let's create a class. So let's open our Eclipse and let's create a class in first. And we'll give it a name as switch. And we'll also check in public static void main. Okay, so the class is created now. And now we'll initialize the scanner to accept the user input. And then we will be comparing it using a switch statement to different cases. And then we'll print the messages accordingly. As mentioned earlier, when the Java compiler reaches a break keyword, it breaks out of the switch block. This will stop the execution of more code. And in this case, testing inside that block will be stopped. Also, when a match is found and the job is done, it's time for a break. There is no need for more testing. A break can save a lot of execution time because it ignores the execution of all the rest of the code in the switch block. And the default code specifies some code to run if there is no case match. So we'll be seeing both of this. And let me just copy one program. So I have already prepared the program. So we'll do one thing. We'll just copy it and then I can explain you the things in it. Okay, so just copy the program. Okay, so in here, we'll have to just import this. Yeah, so now this program, what it will do is, using this scanner, SC, it will first of all ask the user to enter his branch from these four options, like MEC stand for mechanical, CS for computer science, ETC for electronics, and CL for civil. So whatever the user inputs, it is captured and it is stored in the student branch. And then it is passed, this variable is passed to the switch statement. So depending upon the input that user has entered, now there are different cases. So if suppose the value is matching with this case, then this particular messages will be printed. And if it is matching with this case, then this particular messages will be printed. So this is the case. So in this way, you can have n number of cases. And lastly, if you can see, there is a default case. So if the value is not matching with any of the case, then this particular message should be printed. And if you observe, there is a break statement in each of the cases. So if suppose the execution has started, and now if this case is matching, so it has printed this message, and now the execution should stop because whatever desired output we wanted, we have got this. So that's why this break will do that for us. So now let us run and see what is the output, and we can run it. And in here in the console window, you can see it has printed enter your branch from the list displayed. So we have to enter any value from this. So let us try CS, and we can see. So it see, once we have entered CS, it went and saw for this case, and this case was matched. So it has printed user branch is computer. This is the first message, and then it has printed user subjects are first semester is this PL, MSCN, whatever we have given in here. So now if we run this program again, and if you specify any different value, then accordingly the value should change and the particular message should be printed. So here you can see we have given a different value. So that is etc. And that's why it has printed user branches, electronics and telecommunication, and whatever the subjects in here. So now we'll run it again, and we will specify a value other than this 4. So if we give any garbage value, so in this it is printing the default message that please enter correct branch. So in this way, we can see we can use switch statement to compare the variable between multiple values. So with this, we come to an end of this session and in this video series, and hope you have liked it. And do type in your suggestions or any questions in the comment section below. In the upcoming session, we'll see more about the different types of loops that will be used in Java. And till then, stay tuned. Thank you.